Today, we are going to discuss about the liberalization, privatization and globalization of higher end professional education system in India. Coming to liberalization, privatization and globalization, we can see at the dawn of the 21st century, we stand poised between a collapsing past and uncertain future. When established landmarks are disappearing and new ones have yet to appear, we find the world facing both quantitative and qualitative changes. Quantitative changes means it is economic growth, there is change in economic growth, technological innovations, and qualitative difference means a new paradigm of an evolving society governed by altogether different ethos. With the end of Cold War and fall of communism, we are left with a world that is more fluid, fragmented and multipolar than ever before. The process of trade liberalization and privatization has also led to economic integration of markets at the global level. Moreover, technological innovations in transport, information and communication have already led to the compression of the economic and learning space. In the era of knowledge-driven economy and learning societies, both formal and informal education is playing an increasingly vital role in promoting economic solidarity, social cohesion, individual growth, sustainable development, and a culture of peace and world citizenship. Our views about the way we live, learn, work, and think about work have changed. The acquisition of knowledge and skills provided by a traditional formal educational setup do not correspond. Therefore, a new paradigm must evolve, that is development, human-centered, environmentally sound and all-inclusive, so as to prepare learners to be contributors to knowledge and not just mere recipients of knowledge. It has opened up new challenges and opportunities for higher education institutions, whether public, private or hybrid. Just a few years ago, we could not have imagined a university without classrooms or a library without books. Nor could we imagine a university existing 10,000 miles away from its students. Nor could we imagine technocrats rather than faculty, academic staff managing sensitive information and knowledge online. Yet all of this is true today. The University of Phoenix, for example, one of the most dynamic among the distance learning universities, has an enrollment of more than 5 lakh students across the world. In US, there are approximately 5,000 institutions offering online education and training. A number of universities are entering into contract with private publishers. Similarly, a large number of private enterprises are entering into agreement with various universities to meet their technological and other requirements or to help them with the distribution of their knowledge-based products. There are abundant examples of private booksellers, food services, and providers of other services, academic and non-academic alike. Given the increasingly corporate culture in our higher education, it is not surprising that education has been included as a service or a commodity under the General Agreement on Trade and Tariff, that is GATT, and the World Trade Organization, WTO. Though UNESCO has been striving hard towards protecting and strengthening higher education as a common good at the global level by promoting pluralism and diversity, on the other hand, inequitable access, capacity building and sharing of knowledge, on the other, the GATT and WTO are striving equally hard towards reducing the barriers to trade in higher education. No wonder then that we find the academic institutions and business enterprises of the North actively selling educational programs to middle income and emerging economies in the South. The former have made collaborative arrangements with overseas institutions or offshore campuses via distance or online education. They are able to use new technologies and international collaboration effectively and rapidly for the education of approximately 150 million students attending about 3,000 universities and colleges worldwide. These institutions operate in a largely unregulated environment, although organizations like GATE, that is Global Alliance for Transnational Education, that is GATE. The GATE have recently come to the forefront with the aim of fostering and maintaining quality in cross-border higher education enterprises. When coming to international context and trends, we can see concept of private higher education is not new. In Asia, private institutions have always been a central part of higher education. Private higher education has been playing a major role in Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, Taipei, Indonesia, and Philippines. In these countries, up to 80% of students attend private institutions. Private higher education is reported to be rapidly growing in China, Vietnam, Cambodia, and other Central Asian republics as well. Generally, private post-secondary institutions are found to be at the lower end in terms of prestige, though there are some high-quality private universities. Another category of new private institution comprises those specializing in fields such as management, technology or education, with the sole aim of offering high-quality academic degrees having market acceptability. The Asian Institute of Technology in the Philippines and National Institute of Information Technology in India fall in this category. Besides private universities and colleges serving the mass higher education market on a massive scale, there are some non-selective institutions run by individuals or families. There are also some institutions sponsored by private non-profit religious groups or ethnic organizations. Many Asian countries already have considerable experience in managing private higher education institutions on a large scale, whereas other countries have picked this up during the last 30 to 40 years. We find a long tradition of private higher education in Asia. We find dramatic changes in terms of public-private mix in Europe. Europe has, in the last few years, there is a high level of change in Europe. Then students are provided with more choice. And education is almost treated as a product or a commodity. And students are treated as consumers or clients. More feasibly, implementing variable fee structures on the basis of ability to pay, adopting practices from business management to increase equitability and economic efficiency, shouldering some government burdens, rectifying inegalitarian or misuse of public provision of higher education, making the government focus on its prime duty towards literacy and basic education, saving public subsidies for public goods, generating revenues and making innovation through experimentation. Most of the Western European countries are still dominated by public universities, while private higher education is becoming more successful in Eastern Europe. In the United Kingdom and many other countries, the distinction between public and private colleges is getting blurrier by the day. One of the reasons is the competition from the new private post-secondary institutions that are more affordable and market-oriented. Another is the change in public policies regarding private initiative in post-secondary education. We also find some new institutions financed by a mixture of public and private resources. Governments are no longer indifferent or hostile to the private sector in most countries. But there is no dearth of example of the post-secondary private institution unable to survive in the wake of harsh competition and the demand for the quality education. For instance, many institutions were forced to close down in Japan. Poor economic performance, falling birth rates, and a decade-old recession were reported to be the prime factor responsible for their closure. Some of the private higher education institutions could not survive, as in Japan. Faculty salaries were accounting almost 60-70% of the operating cost. In the same way, Ugandan government has had to clamp down on private tertiary institutions operating illegally. The National Council for Higher Education in Uganda published a list of 13 private degree awarding authorities that is licensed and warned against enrolling in a non-authorized institution. Uganda is representative of most African countries where we find a sharp rise in private higher education. Most of it has occurred as unregulated surprise and unanticipated development. In most of these cases, the governments are engaged in more clearly defining roles in private higher education, regulating these institutions and guarding the interests of the students or clients against low quality suppliers in open markets. In Kenya, what happened is it provides another example where the number of students seeking private higher education is declining. In Kenya, private higher education has a longer history than in most other states in Africa, but their share in student enrollment is declining as a result of the adoption of the Module 2 program by the public universities. Here, the private universities are also facing challenges from entrepreneurial foreign universities from South Africa. In most African countries, the assessment and accreditation bodies have been set up by national or provincial government to regulate quality, curricula, fee structure, faculty competence, accessibility, etc. A large number of private higher education institutions end up filling the gap between supply and demand or performing traditional socio-economic functions. Most of them, most of these institutions remain public as well as their missions are concerned. Private institutions worldwide are generally criticized for their privateness, their lack of quality or accessibility, or their contribution to the commercialization or commodification of private education. It is not generally recognized, however, that is always a private that dominates both public and private. Neither privatization nor nationalization could have occurred without the prior consensus or nexus between business and politics. Moreover, the private sector can cater to diversified needs on a smaller or more select basis more easily than can the public sector. In fact, the public sector can also be given credit for the expansion of higher education in most countries in the last 3 decades. It can provide quality education to the elite, vocational education to the needy, and low quality education to those who neither merit nor can afford a better education. It can also provide education to those who are already employed through distance or online education on any time, anywhere basis.